Easter Park community as we gather this day in a new way in order to be reminded that we are loved by God, that we are saved through what Jesus does for us on the cross. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, we are now called to be together as one in our homes, with our families, and new ways as we live into this time of uncertainty. And so we're glad that we're here this morning. A few things to kind of keep in your mind as we move through this uncertainty. First off, Pastor Mary and myself are going to recover and Andrea and Gary are pulling together resources for video song worships that will be available on Wednesday nights and on Sunday mornings so that we continue with the normalcy of being together and worshiping God and giving thanks for the raising of God this morning. So this coming Wednesday, Paige Erickson is going to be our guest speaker. And the following week will be Cindy Jensen Johnson. So we encourage you to check in on Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings. And those resources will be available both on Facebook and on YouTube and will be sending out links to those as well. We also are continuing to monitor the situation and as things are unfolding, listening to our local leaders as to what needs to take place in order for us to take care of our bodies in order to take care of the entire body of Christ, the entire world. And so we want you to know that you are loved by God, that we are thinking and praying for you, and that we're in this together. And so with that, let's begin. Bend your ear to us, O God, and hear our prayers. By your gracious life and death for us, bring light into the darkness of our hearts, and anoint us with your Spirit. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A reading of Psalm 23, a reduction done by Leonard Sweet, based on from his book, Teaching Mystery, the things like this. Draw me today, into fresh encounters with Jesus, O God. Make me a servant of love, so that others may know how much you love them, and I may know how much you love me. Let me not be afraid of new pastures, whether they are green or dry or parched. And as I pass through wherever the day's valleys, keep my head lifted to the mountains, from whence my hope comes. Never let me forget the people that Jesus welcomed, the beauty and the great, the bad and the good, the respected and the cheats, even as the world becomes more callous and cruel. May I never underestimate your capacity to fashion the miraculous from the monsters, even to make me a choice masterpiece in the mire and the pain. Through Thanksgiving.
Good morning. So how are you all settling into this new normal? It's different, right? So Friday afternoon, John and I took Mom and Dad out for a drive just to get out of the house for a while. We drove along the river and all the way down across Minnehaha Parkway. We drove through the neighborhoods that we'd both grown up in, went and saw old houses. Drove by my brother's house, called him up, said we're out front. He and his family and their dog came out and waved, you know. We rolled down the windows, waved back. Same thing at my daughter's house, saw the grandkids up on the porch, waved, how you doing? So we were driving home, my dad said, Mary, how about you let your mom and I take you and John out for dinner tonight? Well, obviously that wasn't going to happen. So many of the little things we take for granted. I miss them. And I miss you. I miss being together on Sunday morning. I miss getting here by Fred Jorgensen and the other early coffee drinkers when I walk in through Reese Hall on Sunday morning. I miss the big hug I always get from Mary Anderson because, well, you know, we do have the best name, as Mary always tells me. I miss being able to say happy birthday, Phyllis Peasley, today. I miss the family gathering. Now, we're recording this service on Saturday morning, but I'll be watching with my family at home, sitting on the couch on Sunday morning. And I'll be thinking of all of you watching, too. And in a way, we'll all be together. So, what do we have for a gospel lesson today? What sacred encounter are we reflecting on this morning? It's from the Gospel of John. I'm doing verses 1 through 11 of chapter 9. Actually, the appointed lesson for today is all of chapter 9, but it's too long to read this morning. But I invite you to go ahead and read it. Read it at home. Read the whole chapter 9. See how the whole drama unfolds, because, I mean, you've got time, right? So here's the beginning of chapter 9. As Jesus walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, well, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When Jesus had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, go, wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. Then the man went and washed and came back, able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, isn't this the man who used to sit and beg? Some were saying, it is he. Others were saying, no, it's just someone like him. He kept saying, I am the man. But they kept asking him, "And how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.'" And wash. Then I went and washed and received my sight. The Gospel of the Lord. So a couple things I want to draw your attention to here. Jesus is walking along with his disciples. And they see a man who has been blind since he was born. He's never known anything else. And the disciples ask what may seem like an odd question. Who sinned? This man or his parents, that he was born blind? See, they're assuming that blindness is a punishment from God for sin. So they wondered, if this man was born blind, when did he have the opportunity to sin? So was it really his parents who sinned, and he gets to pay the price? The disciples' question reveals their underlying assumption that an individual's physical disability, an individual's personal suffering, is a result of their sin, a punishment from God. Concept, right? No one believes that anymore, do they? You know, when I was a girl, which really was not so long ago, maybe 50 years, but during that time, about 50 years ago, my grandmother lived with us for a while. We called her Granny. Now, Granny was the prayingest, most faithful, most devout, most Jesus-loving person that I have ever known. I have a picture of her. Put it up in a second. This is a picture of her with her Sunday school class. Granny knew her Bible. She taught her Bible. She was faithful till the day she died. But Granny, for all her faith, had the same kind of notion that the disciples had, that if something bad happened to someone, God must be punishing them. I remember when she broke her hip. She racked her brain trying to think of what she had done, what sin she had committed, that God should have reason to punish her. I was a young girl, but I remember that. It made an impression on me. So Granny died over 40 years ago. That was a long time ago. People don't still think that suffering is a direct punishment from God, do they? Well, I think you're already seeing it with this COVID-19 pandemic. And I have seen some things of that. This suggestion that this is a punishment from God for human sin. Really? God been keeping a tally, watching and waiting to see us mess up, now meeting out punishment in the form of a novel virus that attacks indiscriminately? Is that how God works? Some would say so. Who sinned? We asked with the disciples. But this man was born blind. My grandmother broke her hip, that this virus should affect the whole world. You know, even as a girl, listening to my granny, I knew deep in my heart that God doesn't work that way. That stuff happens. People suffer. Blindness is a reality. Bones break. People get sick. We all die. And an angry, vindictive, mean-spirited God isn't causing those things to happen to punish us. Those things, many things, all things, both hard and wonderful things, happen. And God is with us through it all. In the midst of pain and struggle, in the middle of our happiness and our celebration, God is with us, holding us close, whatever the circumstances, bringing us healing and restoration and joy, giving us strength for the journey and the assurance of something more. That's what the deal is with Jesus, you know. Jesus, God incarnate, God in flesh, God with skin on, God with us. Back to the rest of today's story from John 9. Remember, the disciples had asked the question, who sinned that this man should suffer? And Jesus, quite simply and without hesitation, upends their assumptions about sin and about God's punishment. Jesus says, nobody sinned. This man's blindness is not about sin and punishment, but now watch. God's glory, the works of God, will be revealed. And then Jesus, the light of the world, the one who reveals the glory of God, the one who opens eyes to God's will and intent for the creation, goes to the man. Notice that the man doesn't approach Jesus first. The man doesn't come and ask for healing and beg for forgiveness. He doesn't display any kind of faith. Jesus goes to him because that's what Jesus does and that's how God is. He spits on the ground, he makes mud, he puts it on the man's eyes, and the man sees. And I think maybe the disciples see as well. Their eyes are opened to a new way of thinking about God, about sin and punishment. Their eyes are open to a new way that involves God's presence and restoration and blessing and healing, not God's wrath and punishment. They see how God really is. They see the glory of God revealed through the action of Jesus. How might our eyes be opened to the glory of God as well? Through this current crisis that we find ourselves in, what will be revealed to us through this about God's presence, God's restoration, God's blessing and healing? Where will Jesus touch our eyes, our hearts, our lives, and bring light and healing? What will we see? I honestly don't know the whole answer yet. Often, it's hard for me to see what will come from us, what God is doing to us. But I have had a few glimpses, and I'll be watching more as we go forward. And I'd be interested to know how your eyes are being opened by this shared threat, the shared experience as well. And it is something we share with one another, with the whole world. So hang in there as our eyes are being opened. And when we get to the other side of this, may we remember what we have seen, what we have learned. What's really important and what we can let go of. Like what it feels like to be connected globally across all the borders. Like the importance of human contact and community. We're not over. We have each other. And God is with us. God loves us and will carry us through to something new that we are only just beginning to see. Amen. Thank you.
the Lord sent him to be born. Let us your servants to one another, signs of your kingdom come. Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church, now into the world.
Of what the future holds, to not worry about tomorrow, but you know how difficult we find it to feed your words. For we worry about so many things, our families, our friends, the circumstances that we find ourselves in. Some worries are bigger than some worries are small. We come before you this day with the big worries and the tiny, and with confidence we lay them at your feet. Loving God, we bring our big worries about health and happiness and security for ourselves and for our loved ones. We bring the big worries about the world in which we live and its future existence as we continue to live in the uncertainty and fear surrounding the COVID-19 pandemic. Continue to bring us into a place of peace in our hearts. Help us to trust our local and national leaders as they make decisions in the best interest of our world. And help us to heed their guidance. In living into this new normal that you give us, help us to have grace for one another and the patience that surpasses our understanding. Lord, in your mercy, give me all the love. Lord God, we know that you are concerned with every aspect of our lives. We also bring the little things that concern us, the worries that keep us awake at night, the worries which only you know. Surround us all, Lord, with your peace and your care and your comfort. We ask you also, Lord, to surround our medical personnel with an added layer of protection as they courageously serve those in need. Be with the truck drivers and the grocery store clerks, pharmacy workers, and all those who are deemed an essential personnel to continue to help us move forward during these challenging times. Lord, in your mercy, hear your prayer. Loving God, reach out to all those for whom the future brings fear and uncertainty. Assure us all that you are with each of us, even when the future seems dark and circumstances feel like they are spiraling out of control. Remind us that you are able to transform even the bleakest of situations and bring healing and fullness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Watch over and bring healing and hope to all who are suffering in mind, body, and spirit. We ask you especially to be with Lois, Jerry, Dick, Maggie, and those who remain in the quiet of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we make our prayers in faith, for we know that your Spirit is working in the world to make all things new, that you hear the cries of our hearts and stand with us in the midst of our trying times. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.
Let us join our hearts and our voices together as we pray the prayer that Jesus prays. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Receive God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.